So first off, I just want to say an enormous, huge, big thank you to everybody who was involved in pulling the Maverick Meerkat together. It was an extraordinary, extraordinary release. I think pretty much everybody here had something to do with it. So give yourselves a big round of applause. You know, whenever we do an LTS, there's this huge pent-up demand to do new stuff, to introduce everything that's been building up. We're usually very conservative. With 10.04, we sync from testing, for example. So there was an enormous amount of new code that had to be brought into Maverick, and we put ourselves on a really tight schedule with a new sort of slightly longer, slightly shorter cadence that accommodates for the holidays. So there was an incredible amount of pressure. I want to thank the release team. Where's the release team? I don't think they got called out earlier. So there's a gravity well over here with Robbie, but Colin and a bunch of other folks, please stand up. You guys did an absolutely awesome job. But Scott gave me a very hard time for the concentrated release, but I just wanted to credit the Kubuntu team with getting their release together despite the shortened cycle. The new cycle, the adjusted cycle, does give us a slightly more balanced TikTok. Which I think will be very useful for us going forward, and it fits in nicely with our LTSs every 2 years. Another huge thing we got done was this was the first release where we actually had a full Linaro cycle. The Linaro guy stood up earlier, so I won't ask him to stand up again, but very well done, and welcome to UDS. It is great to have you guys here. Linaro is a really important project. It's an attempt to create both a forum for really important upstream development work, which we're delighted to be participating in. We're delighted to have sort of defined and discussed here at UDS, but it's also a genuine move towards creating a common base for an enormous amount of Linux work that happens in consumer electronics and in the embedded world. So welcome, Linaro folks, and congratulations on your upcoming release. It's due out, what, in the next week or two? Brilliant. Other folks to call out, where's Evan Dandry and the installer? Evan, congratulations. I saw so many comments. It's sort of amazing how Linux has progressed over the last 14 Ubuntu releases, 7 years. It really is something that we can start promoting and, you know, giving those CDs to just about anybody and expecting them both to have a smooth installation experience and a delightful result once they've got it up and running. The desktop team did amazing stuff. There's too much to call out. One of the big new chunks was the sound indicator, which is some really classy work. I wanted to thank Sebastian. Where's Sebastian? For shepherding our desktop work. This is a really tricky time on the desktop, and you did a superb job. And Connor, where's Connor? Thank you for your work on the sound indicator. From a developer point of view, Ubuntu distributed development, I think, is a really important initiative, right? Lowering the barriers to participation. We already have a phenomenal, amazing, energized, and huge community. But we should make it trivial for anybody to fix anything anywhere in the platform. And so Ubuntu distributed development literally gets us to the point where people can say, you know, bzdr branch the package, bzdr push, and make a merge proposal. So I think we'll be empowering our core community, the folks who really are custodians of the platform, across all of our sort of various groups. John has complicated slides showing all of the permutations and combinations with, you know, another order of magnitude of participants, all of whom have unique insight, unique skills, interesting new approaches, and sort of solutions to problems. So James Westby, Barry Warsaw, well done. I hope that this next cycle is the one where UDD becomes the way we build Ubuntu, and look forward to seeing what you produce. Software Center took a huge leap forward as well. So Michael, Matthew, NPT, and Gary, where are you guys? Stand up and take a bow. We set the goal with 10.10 that we would be able to deliver software directly to end users, and we would provide a framework for commercial software to be delivered directly to users. And I think that's really important. We have always taken a sort of open, heterogeneous approach. The world is changing. We want developers to target Linux as a platform. Increasingly, it's possible to target Linux as a platform, as a first-class citizen, and so we need to create mechanisms for commercial ecosystems to grow up around free software and alongside free software. So well done to that team. I have two big thank yous. One to Jane Silver, who led Canonical for this full cycle and did an extraordinary job. I'm having a lot of fun in my new pursuits, and unfortunately, me having a lot of fun, you know, means that that Jane has to manage me. But Jane has done an extraordinary job of really raising the game at Canonical. So she's not here yet, but you will see her later in the week. And for those of you who are who alongside me appreciate that, please thank her. And Rick Spencer, who took on the overall leadership of Ubuntu, the platform, and all of the work that we do that reaches out to the long tail of the community out there. Rick, you did a sterling job. Thank you very much for your leadership. On the cloud front, right at the very end of the cycle, there was this brilliant idea to let anybody use the cloud for 42 minutes. I don't know why they picked 42 minutes, but anybody in the world could use Ubuntu in the cloud for 42 minutes. Davey, where's Davey?
Fixing the scheduler.
Fixing the scheduler. Now, if you hadn't said that, nobody would know that the scheduler was busted. But so in absentia, kudos to Davey and a whole bunch of people who worked around him. I think the cloud is becoming sort of a first stop for people who want to get stuff done and innovate on Linux on the server. And so so putting 10 out there so crispy, so clean was a brilliant idea. Very well done to Davey and to a whole team of folks who kind of made that happen on the server team and elsewhere. And last but not least, we shipped an entirely new netbook interface. We put Unity on the netbook and put it out to the world. And there are some folks who deserve a tremendous amount of credit and thanks for that. Didrox, where's Didrox? The new machine. Having Unity out there, you know, we've previously done a lot of work with OEMs and we've done custom interfaces for OEMs. But it's amazing what we learn when we simply take something and make it available to the world at large without having to sort of buy the hardware to go with it. So that created the opportunity for us to do some focused research. We have capacity now within the Canonical design team to do dedicated user research. And it's really interesting to watch or participate in this kind of program. You invite people in. They're typically people who've never heard of or seen Ubuntu before. We've run 15 sessions just focused on Unity and many more sessions focused on other aspects of Ubuntu. We've run those sessions in China and in the UK, so we're trying to get a sort of multicultural perspective of the way people feel about Ubuntu. We do very close observation around a set of sort of everyday activities. So essentially we say to somebody, here's a new computer and has, you know, to all intents and purposes, a new version of Windows, if that's how they think of their PC. Tell us how it works for you. How about trying to get these things done? Get your photos onto Flickr, produce a word processor, set up Skype and communicate with your grandma. And then we make observations, essentially. It's a very detailed, analytical process. We got some great feedback, some very positive commentary. I really like this one. This idea that the new interface, that Unity on the netbook is kind of like a bridge from the computer to the phone. And one of our real goals with Unity was to create a more device-like feel. Right? As computers become more mobile, they become less and less like sort of general purpose workhorses where you might have lots and lots of different things going on at the same time. So this device feel was something that we really tried to create and that seemed to come through. There's a real sort of focus in the commentary on usability and clarity, so that was very validating. Another nice comment here was somebody was saying that the styling was really attractive to them, that it came across as very clear what you're doing, where you're doing. There was also quite a bit of negative feedback. We had literally hundreds of bugs filed, which is awesome. Didrox did an incredible job of keeping us sort of with a clear, coherent view of what the most important things were. And I want to credit both the design and the DX teams for their response. There were lots and lots of issues identified, responses planned, and executed. I think we fixed something like 150 bugs in the final 6 weeks. So that was really useful. Having having Unity out there for the whole world in our netbook interface means that we've probably had reported to us now about 80% of the issues. And so that's a really, really good starting point for us to be planning the next release. Some of the feedback that we got was kind of subliminal, though. I don't know if you know, but Jono has the second life as a lead singer in a thrash metal band. Is that right? My sort of cultural,
that's right.
Yeah, sort of other end of the spectrum. You know, James Blunt, Jono. But anyway, So I was really curious about this severed fifth thing, and I heard there was a release coming up. So I went on to Jono's sort of Ustream where he does a great sort of community building exercise around the band, and I happened to sort of notice one of probably the world's best examples of advertising placement ever. Now, I'm not sure if the help itchy dog with allergy advert was aimed at me, or if it was content related, but anyway, I was delighted and wanted to congratulate Jono on the release of Severed Fifth's new album until I saw the cover and the title, which was Nightmares by Design. So thanks for the feedback, Jono. Next time you can just fight the bug, you know? Anyway, so there are a couple of key things that we absolutely have to nail in the next cycle around Unity. The number one issue is drivers and performance. There's a fascinating pattern that you can see if you subscribe to the Unity bug reports and you read all the comments. That is, when folks are filing a bug, if they have certain hardware and it runs like treacle, then those are angry bugs. And the same bug filed as a duplicate by someone who has hardware which is running smoothly, those are happy bugs. You know, oh, there's a bug, let's fix it. As opposed to, well, I can't really repeat what an angry bug sounds like. The drivers and performance are going to be our number one issue. We're going to do a lot of work around the GL stack in the next round. The hardware is there. You know, if you look at all of the netbooks that are shipping today, they have GL capabilities in the hardware. We just have to figure out how to turn that on. We're kind of leading the way on this, but essentially the work that we're doing is really important for the broader ecosystem. All of the new sort of window management work, a lot of GNOME Shell and other platforms all essentially depend on getting the stack right. So us being out in front should be of substantial benefit to everybody else. We're going to do a much more sophisticated job of detecting when it works and redirecting to a 2D experience when it doesn't. Sometimes it turns out software drivers lie about what they do and what they don't do. And so we'll have to build a really credible effort to make sure that nobody ever gets a really bad 3D experience when they could get a really slick 2D experience. We also picked up a lot of issues around file management. Now, we want to move the world past files and folders. If you sit and watch users working with their PCs in a very connected world, the files and folders way of thinking is completely broken. And it's not just broken for casual users. It's broken for sophisticated users too. You know, I spend a lot of time trying to remember where on earth I put a particular file in which directory and so on. And I'm only starting the slow decline to senility now. So I really want to make sure that we get this right before I get there, which is going to take about 2 years. So by the LTS, we need to have everything nailed. With Unity, we made users' life a little harder because we really wanted to move so fast towards a world where the content that you need is just right there, brought to you through search and in the dash, that we kind of took away some of the familiar file management tools that people are used to. So we're going to course correct on that front. We're going to, at least as a temporary step, we're going to bring Nautilus back on the desktop so that you can have a desktop where you can sort of use as a staging post for your files and folders. We'll also put the file manager on the launcher. And we're doing a lot of work with the Zeitgeist community, who incidentally have been absolutely awesome. Who's here from the Zeitgeist community? All right, Safe got scotched on the visa, but there are other folks here as well. And I just wanted to thank them for being such a great community and for their real persistence. You know, it's difficult to change the way people think. And this is a community that has a clear vision and has really been pushing hard. And we're delighted to support them in that, bring their work into Ubuntu and take it to the world. So a round of applause for the Zeitgeist guys. We're going to iterate on the Places interface, which is essentially the full screen interface where we'll bring file management. We're also going to do a lot of work to enable developers to create third-party places. It's really straightforward to do. So if you have any kind of data source, sets of data, sets of things that you think people want to be able to search, that present in the dash, that's straightforward to do. Interestingly, in watching people use Unity on the netbook, we saw them struggling with window management. We saw them struggling to try and arrange to be able to do multiple things at the same time. Even though they're on a netbook, which really should be optimized for sort of doing one thing at a time, people were trying to use it like a desktop. And that was very interesting. We actually had a series of bugs filed by people saying, you know, they really want Unity as their primary default interface. So we're going to do a bunch of work around window management just to crystallize out the easy cases for people who want to be doing two or three things at the same time. So you'll see quite a lot of work from us in the next cycle around window management. But we saw several bugs and at least one community blueprint filed saying that people wanted Unity on the desktop. And so, having done all of the research, having put these plans together and built some confidence in this, today we're going to take the step of committing to probably our most significant change ever on the desktop, and that is desktop Unity. We'll make Unity the default experience for new users to Ubuntu, where we are absolutely confident that they have the geo hardware and the software drivers, and we've lined all of the pieces up to make sure that they have a fantastic experience. There is a lot of work to be done to make that an awesome experience for people. One community in particular that is underserved by the current Unity is the community that depends on having good accessibility hooks. So Luke Yelovich is going to be rotating into the team. Is Luke here?
Yeah.
Brilliant. Welcome, Luke, and thanks for taking this on. Luke is going to be rotating into the Unity team, and we'll have this as a focus. We'll have some additional folks working on it. We'll have full ATK integration with Unity in the cycle, and we'll also use that for our test harnesses as well. So we'll do a lot more integration testing so that we can actually get automated feedback on whether Unity is working well on different hardwares on any given day. I talked about the Places API, so we will work hard to make sure that it's straightforward for developers to create their own places. There'll be a sample project which makes it really easy to sort of just branch and build your own places and integrate that into the global search. And at unity.ubuntu.com, you'll find a sort of landing page for all of the various projects that make up the Unity experience. We have phenomenal participation already. At the design level, we have a very active design list. I think it's the most active design forum, essentially, in free software. We want to continue to build on that and engage with the design community. We want to celebrate projects that embrace design. So we will run a program that essentially coaches projects to embrace design, helps designers work with those projects, and recognizes the projects that are part of any of our core interfaces, whether it's Kubuntu, Ubuntu, or Edubuntu, which have embraced design and made the biggest steps forward. So we'll continue to build the community there. Ultimately, this gets us back to a one CD experience. We'll have a single CD, and when you install it, we'll detect what your hardware capabilities are, what your form factor is, and we'll give you the very best experience that we possibly can for that hardware. Now the platform team, led by Rick Spencer, is going to be making the call. So this is the Rick Spencerometer. This is Rick's view of where we stand today in regard to Unity by default. So essentially, Rick is looking at all of these different aspects like dash performance, indicator performance, file management, the ability to find and launch apps, the functionality of the launcher, accessibility, window management. And so this is a nice sort of snapshot view of how we're doing. The red line is where we want to get to. So this isn't sort of global warming in Antarctica. This is global warming on the desktop. And so Rick will be updating this regularly and sort of keeping his finger on the pulse. I'll be watching that like a hawk, as will everyone else who's involved in the project. This is Canonical is very complex, and our community is very complex. But this is one of the initiatives that really does unify many different threads of our activity. We have very active participation in this from the folks who work with OEMs. The response from OEMs to Unity has been absolutely awesome, which gives us confidence to know it will ship to millions and millions of users, and that gives us access to a very deep pool of QA and user-centered design. There are folks committed to this from the community. There are folks committed to this from our design team, our desktop team, our desktop engineering team, and from the platform team. So it really is a unifying moment for the project. But it is a significant step. It is a risky step. It is going to throw people's confidence, and we are going to have to focus a lot of attention to keep folks focused on making a success of it. I want to sort of preempt one very, very important question that I expect would be the first question that folks will ask when we get to Q&A, and that is the relationship between Ubuntu and GNOME and Unity and GNOME. And so the best way for me to put this is straightforward. Unity is a shell for GNOME. It may not be GNOME shell, but it is a shell for GNOME. And we're exercising all the same pipelines. We're exercising all the same APIs. We're absolutely committed to the principles and values of usability and simplicity that GNOME has espoused. We have a phenomenal relationship with many GNOME upstreams who are working to make sure that their apps look and feel and perform beautifully in a Unity environment. The world is a much more complex place today than it was 10 years ago, and I think it's healthy and good for GNOME to have Unity, to have a certain amount of competition, a certain amount of innovation, a certain amount of diversity in the ecosystem. And we're certainly committed to making a success of that. It is challenging in a world where, you know, we are all part of a sort of an enormous movement towards free software, but where there are differences in that community. And as Ubuntu has sort of risen to the fore, some of those differences have sort of come to prominence. I don't know if you've ever noticed, but groups that have a huge amount in common often can become very fractious. I was reading something by Joel Spolsky, who labeled this the narcissism of small differences. Apparently Sigmund Freud, back in the 20s, actually talked about this, how groups that are sort of typically small, rebellious groups that are sort of trying to change the world can often end up more focused on each other and their differences with each other than their differences with, you know, the world that they're trying to change. There's a beautiful clip of this in one of my favorite movies, Monty Python's Life of Brian, so I just wanted to put that up very briefly.
Are you the Judean People's Front?
Fuck off!
What?
Judean People's Front. Well, the People's Front of Judea. Judean People's Front. Come,
wankers. Can I join your group?
No, piss off.
I didn't want to sell this stuff. It's only a job. I hate the Romans as much as anybody.
Are you sure?
Oh, dead sure. I hate the Romans already.
Listen, if you wanted to join the PFJ, you'd have to really hate the Romans.
I do.
Oh, yeah? How much?
A lot.
Right, you're in. Listen.
The only people we hate more than the Romans are the fucking Judean People's Front.
Yeah. Yeah. Split us.
And the Judean Popular People's Front.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Split us. And the People's Front of Judea.
Yeah. Split us.
What? The People's Front of Judea. Split us.
We're the People's Front of Judea.
Oh, I thought we were the Popular Front.
People's Front.
Whatever happened to the Popular Front?
Eh? He's over there.
Yeah! It's amazing how relevant Monty Python can be. So look, all I'll say is we are all in this together, right? Canonical, our community, the extended community, GNOME, KDE, Kubuntu, right? There's the Romans, and there's us. So let's make sure we work well together. And that's something that we try to live by here in Ubuntu. This is going to be something of a challenge, but I feel really good about what we're doing and how what we're doing is beneficial to that broader fundamental change that's happening in the world. So, one of the really cool things that landed in 10.10 was UTouch. Where's the Touch team? Duncan, Chase, Steve, bunch of folks, Iqbal. Well done. Thank you very much for us. If we're going to take free software to the world, we have to be current and relevant on the world's interfaces, on the world's hardware. And I'm convinced that in 2 years' time, 3 years' time, it'll be very difficult to buy a laptop that doesn't have a sophisticated multi-touch interface. And thanks to that team's work, you'll be able to use that fully on Linux, on any distribution, as richly and as usefully, and hopefully perhaps even more usefully than you can on the proprietary platforms. So that was a really important first step. That interface will see, or those APIs will see, substantial work during the cycle. We do have, I think, all of the hardware vendors that are actively building multi-touch hardware talking to us. Linux is obviously very, very significant in consumer electronics, and all of those consumer electronics are moving towards colored touch screens. So UTouch, it looks like UTouch is going to be sort of the de facto standard for everybody on Linux. We have folks working on GTK integration. Cody Russell here from Canonical, working with other folks in the GTK community this week and last week. I think there was a sprint around GTK, and that was part of it. We have folks, I think, here this week from Nokia and from the Qt platform, and we'll be working to integrate UTouch with Qt. So we can have a single consistent gesture framework across all applications on the desktop, which is going to be really awesome. Thank you everybody for coming. The focus in the next cycle is going to be integrating touch into applications and starting to make it really, really easy for developers to build touch applications. So hopefully in Natty, we'll have Events fully touch enabled, we'll have IF GNOME fully touch enabled. We would like to have the browsers fully touch enabled. I believe we have folks here from Mozilla, so it would be brilliant to talk with them about touch and the web, touch and the browser. Of course, we'll integrate touch into the shell as well, into Unity and into our 2D experience. So this is the beginning of the push through to our next LTS. When we ship Natty, we'll be halfway there. I want to start cultivating this idea that we should be perfectionists. In 8.04, after we shipped 8.04 LTS, we said we're going to build a desktop user experience that can compete with the very best in the world, that people will look at and lust after, that will be desirable, that will be usable, that will be beautiful. We're halfway there now, we're halfway to that goal. 12.04 is when we have to have it absolutely perfect. So everybody should start, I think, feeling like a perfectionist, right? We should start, we're at a point now where we need to start refining. I want to demonstrate perfectionism in a very visceral way. There's some folks, I think, who are absolutely critically responsible for the way people, you know, get that desktop, and I think they deserve a treat. So some of them are up here. So maybe Rick, Robbie, someone from the design team, Vanka should come up. Who else is really responsible for that sense of, wow, it's just perfect? Who's that? Neil, you should come up as well. Come on. Sorry, no one's prepared for this. This is totally off the reservation. These guys have no idea what's coming. So who are, there's a couple of other folks there. Seb, where's Seb? I hope you have a sweet tooth. Come on up. All right. So I have a bit of a treat for you here. Who else? Jason, you should definitely be up here. Pete. Colonel's not back room. Okay, so what we have here is we have a nice bowl of ice cream for these folks over here. And that bowl of ice cream represents the sweet taste of a perfect Ubuntu experience. Right? Now, if you guys don't want to start eating that ice cream just yet. Who else? How many do you have? Do you have any more up there?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah,
anybody else feeling hungry? Anybody else want that, just like that?
Dead Rocks.
That nice sugar rush in the morning. Dead Rocks, where's Dead Rocks?
Oh, ripped.
Evan, where's Evan?
Yeah, Evan.
Evan.
That one for me.
Oh.
Two more.
And do you have the box? All right, so it's very important that these come. Did not see you go. Have a bowl of ice cream. Okay. So this ice cream, this is great ice cream, right? This is sweet, perfect ice cream. But there's one thing, so, and I know you guys, I've kept you here for a while, now you probably would like to eat the ice cream, but I need to tell you something. In one of these bowls of ice cream is a fly. It's just one fly. Very small fly. Not feeling so good about the ice cream, are you? So things like a boot that splashes text up, that's a fly, right? When people see that, that's not a bowl of ice cream, that's a fly in the bowl of ice cream. Anyway, so the good news is, folks, the fly is actually... Where's the fly? Oh. The fly's right here, actually. It's in my bowl of ice cream. It's a Harry Potter chocolate fudge fly from Universal Studios, and we'll be handing them out later. There you go. I promise there's no real flies in your ice cream. Thanks very much. If your screen flickers during boot, file a bug and help us fix it. If your indicators aren't neatly spaced and properly aligned, file a bug and help us fix it. If the icons are the wrong size, file a bug and help us fix it. It's time for us to start getting really precise, really focused. Details matter. Let's make it perfect. We've got three releases before ILTS. So let's make it absolutely perfect. In that spirit, I want to celebrate some awesome work from the Paper Cutters team and Vish. Where is Vish? Vish, welcome.
Yeah.
I had to write a letter to the US consulate in Chennai to explain that yes, we really did, a European company really did want to fund the doctor from Chennai to come to Florida to work on free software. But thank you very much. I'm very glad that you made it, and thank you for your leadership of the Paper Cuts project. It's really important. It's beautiful work. And it's exactly the sort of attention to detail, to making the platform better, the experience better, that we need. So, well done. We're going to kick off a project, again, in that spirit, this cycle, which won't complete in the cycle, but it's to produce a new icon theme. In keeping with the styling of Radiance and Ambience, it'll be a completely open, free theme. It'll be led by the design team in partnership with the community. We'll bring in professionals. It'll be a similar model to the one that we followed around the Ubuntu font. That work won't complete in the cycle. It's just too big a project. But we need to start it now, and we may land pieces of it in the cycle. We need to start it now if we want to get it complete by 11.10 and perfect for 12.04. Okay, Software Center. So I called out MPT Michael and Gary for phenomenal work. It took a great deal of effort from lots of different teams, actually, to make the first goal of Ubuntu Software Center, the ability to actually just buy software, make that work. In this next cycle, we want to create the ability for anybody to sponsor, essentially, any project that has a package in Ubuntu directly through the Software Center. So you'll be able to go to the Software Center, you'll be able to find a project for, you know, the project page or the page for the software that you use. You'll be able to sponsor that project any amount you like, and through Ubuntu One, using the same mechanism that commercial projects can use to sell their software, you'll be able to provide funding to the projects that you use. So I think that's a really important initiative. We have to create a vibrant, healthy ecosystem for our projects. Part of that means figuring out ways to show our support directly to them, giving them the funding that they need to really raise the game, to get people to conferences, to get people, you know, to get design reviews done, to get all the details taken care of. That will make free software projects in general competitive with the best projects in the world. So that work will build on efforts in the Ubuntu One team. Congratulations to the Ubuntu One team. Maverick really pulled Ubuntu One out of beta and made it something that I use every day, that I think lots of people are starting to use every day. It's a really starting to be a rich and interesting platform and service. So congrats to that team. Where are they? Well, oh, what's with this? Everybody else is standing up. Some really big changes, syncing more than just files, so syncing contacts, syncing bookmarks, syncing rich data, supporting multiple platforms, Android, iOS, Windows, and allowing third-party developers to build services that are part of Ubuntu One, so essentially combining services and data in really, really rich, interesting ways. The third-party app developer piece is the focus in this cycle, along with integration with web platforms like Facebook, like Google. So Ubuntu One's going to get even more interesting, I'm really looking forward to the work that the team does in this cycle. There is far too much for me to try and embrace it all in the speech. If you look at the schedule, as John has said, it's pretty packed. There are literally hundreds of projects that are going to have their say as part of this conference. We make really tough decisions about which ones we're going to put out there by default, which ones we're going to support in main, which ones we want to make sure have specific versions in the archives. There's something for everybody. This is the best pulse, essentially, of the free software ecosystem. So if you have something that you think should be on this list, invite those guys to the next UDS. It's they're also an event, and I want to wish you all a really, really good, solid summit. I want to introduce Dave Rosling, the CTO of Lenaro. Dave, would you like to come up? There's a Lenaro team. I don't know if they stood up earlier. Did you guys want to take a quick bow?
I won't keep you stood up, and I won't keep you for long. I can compete with Mark and ice cream. So. 6 months ago in Belgium, Lenaro hadn't been formed. We were here in stealth mode as ARM, and that was great. For all of you Developer Summit newbies who haven't a clue what's going to happen, it's a really good event. It's a very geeky week. If you want to sit in meetings discussing memory segmentation and how it saves you energy and power, battery life, then it's a really good place. I really love it, so it's good. Anyway, in the last 6 months, with the help of many wonderful people, such as, I'll name a few of them, Kiko, Loic, Anmar, Alexander, Michael, Amit, various others, too many to mention, really, built an organisation from roughly nothing to about 70, and that's engineers from six different companies all working together and with the open source. So this is just the start of it, that we didn't really have a full cycle, we didn't have everyone on board. And this time we're putting a lot of work together for the next cycles as we hit the next bits. So I won't ramble on too much, but have a really lovely week. It's a really wonderful event, and enjoy yourself and meet lots of good people. Cheers.
Thank you, David. You're welcome. Just in my own observations, ARM is showing up in really interesting places. There will be sessions on ARM on servers. I think the Smoothstone folks will be here, and that's kind of fascinating. I know that the server team is really interested in making sure that the Ubuntu Server Edition works really well on that platform. ARM now is a first-class platform for everything that we do in Ubuntu. We will make sure that you can run Unity brilliantly on 800 megahertz ARM processors. I saw an absolutely awesome Tegra 2-based Toshiba AC100. Where is that device? Is it in the room? That is the coolest device I've seen in a very, very long time. Bring it up, Michael. So I think we're going to see, I think this is going to be a really profound shift in the sort of blurring of the lines between consumer electronics and the PC world. Now, isn't that a beautiful piece of carbon fiber? So this is now available in general retail in Germany, and where else?
That one here for
France.
This one came from France?
No, brand. From the UK.
From the UK. So widely available. Android out of the box. Ubuntu installs perfectly on it. Who did the work on that?
Oliver.
Oliver? Ogre? Stand up and take a bow. That was really, that's really awesome. I'm going to get one, and I can't wait to see these. Sort of in, what's that? His flight is overbooked. All right, so he'll be here and jet lagged shortly. But I think this is the beginning of a fundamental shift in the ecosystem, and I'm delighted that we're right there at the beginning. We also have folks here from the OpenStack community. Where are they? Have they arrived? Back there, some very familiar faces. Happy to have you guys back. Cloud is really important to us. Ubuntu is an open ecosystem. Our cloud platform remains Eucalyptus, but we're delighted to have the OpenStack guys here. We want to make sure that if people are going to deploy OpenStack, that they can do it smoothly, beautifully, easily on Ubuntu. So welcome, and for those of you interested in the OpenStack API and the ecosystem that's forming around it, I'm sure you'll enjoy those sessions as well. Right, wrapping up. In the last couple of years, we have pushed a series of ideas. We didn't come up with those ideas. We're simply trying to carry them forward. Cadence, you know, we came into the world once GNOME had proven you could actually release many projects at the same time on a regular cadence and benefit strongly. And we've tried to carry that philosophy forward to the whole open source ecosystem. I really see that starting to happen now. I see lots of projects saying that they want to get their release date done in time for like in coordination with GNOME's or in coordination with our feature freeze, so that they can be assured that they know exactly which version is going to be shipping. I think this is a meme that is going to spread. I'm delighted that we have Fedora and other projects on a 6-month cadence. You know, I really think this is a good thing for free software, and it's going to continue to get better. I also see other projects starting to talk about LTSs, and so I think we'll start to see the 2-year cadence and the importance of that becoming more widely accepted. Design, we started talking about back at 804, and it's taken us time, but we're now starting to really put our work that I think shines, and we can put on a global stage. And I'm really delighted that it's not just us. Again, the Fedora design team doing good work. Design kicking up in the sort of Libre Graphics Summit. Lots of projects starting to get good at design. And the next big push for us is going to be quality. There's this idea that we have, it's a sort of a slight smugness, that open source is always, by definition, better quality. And it's true, there are some deep motivating factors that help drive quality in open source. But we can do much, much more, and we can be much, much better. And so a key thing that I'm asking everyone to start thinking about, I'm not coming to the table with any specific concrete proposals or plans yet, but a key thing that I think we should start thinking about is how this community can help the whole free software movement raise the game on quality. We're in a great position because we actually see how the pieces come together. We have phenomenal infrastructure in Launchpad. Things like daily builds providing very rapid feedback cycles are going to be really important. Things like automated tests providing, you know, smoke tests and unit tests providing a very clear signal as to where we stand on any given day as to quality are going to be really important. If you have ideas and thoughts on this, I think we need to surface them. We need to start projecting them. We need to start coaching and learning and thinking about quality. So that's all from me. I want to wish you all a fantastic UDS. The novel is going to do us proud. It's going to be, again, a semi-crazy wild rush. We've got a lot to get done, but I think the sunshine is going to help. So with that, let's wrap up. I'll hand you back to. Do I hand you back to John? All right. I think we take a break at this stage. So thank you very much, everybody. Have a great UDS.